And welcome back to KCN Friday Briefing. Well, I promised Reverend Lissy Natasha, and she's here. Thank you so much for joining us.
It's my pleasure.
I have to say, you look really, really nice.
I'm humbled. Thank you.
You know, so when I said you're coming on the show, mm-hmm. there are very many varied reactions.
Uh-huh.
And the one question that people wanted me to ask is if you are single. That was uh-huh. the first one. Can you imagine that?
Oh, I wonder why.
I wonder why. But before we even get to that question, because I know that one many people are waiting to mm-hmm. hear. So tell us, who is Reverend Lissy Natasha?
Reverend Lissy Natasha is basically a young lady mm-hmm. that is that has the calling of God on her life mm-hmm. and that is passionate about reaching the unreached with the gospel. So Reverend Lissy Natasha is also the founder of the Prophetic Latter Glory Ministries mm-hmm. International, mm-hmm. which is an interdenominational outreach ministry that is holding crusades, conferences, mm-hmm. seminars, and revivals
wow.
in Kenya and other places. In short.
That's a nice intro. So uh-huh. how is it that you decided to become a church leader, a reverend? I mean, was it like a calling? Mm. Was it something you always wanted mm. to be from when you were younger?
Uh-huh. You know, actually, when you speak about calling, Betty, I can say it's not something that you choose. Mm-hmm. A calling is by the election of grace. Mm-hmm. So it is a calling. And I never thought I would be on this path. But by the election of grace, the calling came while I was quite young. So
well, what age?
It was not a personal preference.
Uh-huh.
The calling came while I was at a very young age by a prophetic word. I was actually 9 years.
Nine.
That is when a prophetic word was spoken that I would become. I'm a pastor, and my mother is also a pastor.
Yeah.
So I come from a background of also other servants of God. But you know, it has been a journey because you don't begin at that point. You're still young. You can't understand it.
Right.
But then the journey began from that point. So I received Jesus at quite a young age uh-huh. as my personal savior. And I began with children crusades. I was a femme kid dancer in faith wow. evangelistic ministry. So the journey began from an early age.
From an early age.
Yes.
And then grew because I mean there are pictures and you know my director will start rolling the pictures mm-hmm. of you actually praying to this mammoths of crowds
mm-hmm.
I mean did you ever think that it will come to that to a mm-hmm. place where people actually you know come to your church or to your you know ministries you know in large numbers?
You know, actually, when I began from humble beginnings.
Yeah.
So, and as I said, the journey began mm-hmm. from children crusades mm-hmm. to later on going to schools mm-hmm. for school rallies
right.
to then going to colleges. Then now much later, when as I continued to grow and I reached the level of whereby my spiritual father, the Archbishop, Bishop Arthur Kitongo of mm-hmm. Redeemed Gospel Church, mm-hmm. also recognized the calling in me and also groomed me and ordained me. And that is when the whole journey began. But I never thought I would be here.
But has it been easy? Because you say to me, you know, you talk with so much uh-huh. ease, and you uh-huh. know, you think like, why this? Her story is, you know, uh-huh. quite was mm-hmm. quite smooth. Her journey was quite smooth. Mm-hmm. But has it always been like that?
No, actually, it has not been smooth. But mm-hmm. one thing I'll say to you, the will of God will never take you where the grace will not protect you.
Wow.
So when God gives you an assignment, He gives you the grace to fulfill the assignment. And you know, we are in the last days when God is not looking for ability but for availability. So I just availed myself to be used by God.
I feel like we're already preaching up in here.
Amen.
Amen to that.
Yes.
So I mean, so now your church has grown, but then the question would be, if you are not a pastor, a mm-hmm. reverend, what else, what do you think you would have, what mm-hmm. path would you have taken?
Yeah, actually most people think that I pastor a church, but the ministry, the Prophetic mm-hmm. Latter Glory Ministries International is not a church.
It is
an outreach.
An outreach right.
ministry that is holding conferences and seminars. So people from different denominations mm-hmm. get mm-hmm. to attend the conferences, mm-hmm. the crusades. Mm-hmm. And if I was not a pastor, I feel I would have been a youth counselor. Because
that's still in the same line.
Really?
What else?
Okay.
What else?
I would have loved to be a youth counselor, maybe a life coach, because uh-huh. I love to inspire people,
right.
especially the youth,
uh-huh.
you know, and just to see them getting inspired. Somebody that has lost hope, when you see that hope being reinstated in
yeah.
them, you know. So I think I would have been a youth counselor,
you know,
or a life coach.
I have like four different careers that I think you'd have fit perfectly.
Which one.
I'll tell you offline. I'll tell you offline. But one of the other things I was reading about you, and one of the things that you also do is you visit, you know, the outreach program you're saying, you visit, yes. you visit prisons.
Yes.
Why do you have that passion to visit, you know, people who are behind bars?
Actually, one of the giftings that God has given me is that is just to give hope to people, because right. encouragement is the foundation to success. Mm-hmm. And these are some of the people that have been forgotten, people that have lost hope, mm-hmm. and they don't see beyond the circumstances they are in.
Right.
So that is why God put a very heavy burden in my spirit to actually visit prisons and just inspire them and tell them there is life beyond that.
Yes, yes. And you have been there for such a long time, but there's one thing that happened, you know, an incident that happened, and you know, you mm-hmm. came to the limelight, and it mm-hmm. was related to Nairobi Senator Mike Sonko, mm-hmm. where, you know, he took up, you know, he posted pictures of you mm-hmm. in his office when you were praying for him. Mm-hmm. What was that all about? Because later on he came and said, you know, I'm still thinking if I should get saved and uh-huh. all this and that. What happened?
Actually, I've been in the ministry, as I said, from an early age.
Right.
And I thank God for the Senator of Nairobi, mm-hmm. Honorable Mike Sonko. And he's one of the people that my ministry has touched through the social media platforms, mm-hmm. because I believe social media platform is my platform every day.
Right.
So I was using it to post my messages on YouTube, mm-hmm. Facebook, you know, and as I was posting my messages, he's one of those people that was blessed. So on posting the messages, a larger percentage of Kenyans and right. many people also got to know of my ministry, those mm-hmm. that did not know, because I'm not always in Kenya.
Right.
Sometimes because of the vision that God has given me for other places, I travel outside. Uh-huh. So now, actually at that point, I had not met the Nairobi Senator.
Yeah.
But much later, I paid him a courtesy visit, mm-hmm. just as Nairobi Senator. Mm-hmm. And I appreciate what he was, his leadership mm-hmm. to the Nairobi residents. Mm-hmm. And I agreed to have a courtesy visit.
Right.
And apparently also, by the time he had lost his father, I was not in the country. So that is the time I also went as a spiritual leader to give my mm-hmm. condolences. But you know, salvation is a personal choice. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people say he got saved, he did not get saved.
Yeah,
but
yes.
that one, it is a personal decision.
Okay.
But I prayed with him mm-hmm. and I met him at that time.
Right,
yes.
right. And you know, after that, the pictures went viral. I can mm-hmm. imagine so many people started, you know, coming and looking for, you know, where is prophetic glory, latter glory, international ministries. There are so many pictures now of like people in buses, and especially guys, you know, just coming like to look for this lady, you know, this pastor, this reverend who's touching lives.
Amen.
Yeah.
You know, actually, there is also, I saw some of the pictures that people are posting.
Right.
And actually, my ministry does not just attract, because, you know, sometimes in a congregation, mm-hmm. people can just pick out a certain picture.
True.
You know?
True.
But
it doesn't attract men alone.
No. Actually, my calling is for the body of Christ. And some of them are also people that have been blessed by my ministry,
right.
and they attend the crusades and the conventions. But it's not mm-hmm. mainly just the men.
So being a young and very attractive, you know, church leader, or, you know, a leader, you know, in servant leadership, how is it hard, you know, leading people and, you know, mm-hmm. making sure that they're following, you know, whatever you're saying or your teachings mm-hmm. for the right reasons?
Yeah, the challenges will always be there.
Yeah.
Whether you are a preacher, a businessman, a politician, everyone will face challenges. So there are those challenges that we face, mm-hmm. but in the midst of those challenges, I always turn to God in prayer, mm-hmm. and I find also encouragement from his word, mm-hmm. and also from people that have gone ahead of me, mm-hmm. like my mentors, mm-hmm. you know, people that have gone ahead of me, people that inspire mm-hmm. me, you know, they keep on encouraging me and they keep me motivated.
Right.
Yes.
And the people who have mentored you, like you said Arthur Kitonga.
Yeah,
who else?
The founder of the Redeemed Gospel right. Church, mm. Bishop Arthur Kitonga, has been my spiritual father. Mm-hmm. And I always tell people, submitting under his anointing has made me what I am. Bishop Margaret Wanjiru mm-hmm. of GM is
yes.
also one of my mentors mm-hmm. spiritually, mm-hmm. that has also been a pillar of strength.
Right.
And also my biological mother, Reverend Esther Wanjiro, who is also a pastor. Mm-hmm. She's pastoring in Maximum Miracle Center, one of the branch churches. She's also one of the people that inspire mm-hmm. me and keep me grounded amongst many other men and yes. women of God yes, from yes. different places.
So what are the challenges that, you know, you face? You mentioned earlier that, you know, everything has challenges.
Yes.
I mean, what challenges do you face?
There are many challenges, especially because my calling is interdenominational. Mm-hmm. So sometimes God will be leading me to go to different places. Mm-hmm. Just last year, I held a conference in Qatar, which is Muslim-dominated in Doha.
Yeah.
So some of the places that God will lead you, you know, Christianity is not easily embraced.
Right.
You know, some places you go, people don't, they don't believe on women. Women can also be in the ministry. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So there are all those kind of challenges you have to overcome because God does not anoint gender.
Right.
You know, the Bible says in the last days, I will pour my spirit upon all flesh. Mm-hmm. So the anointing is not it's a not thing of gender.
Right.
You know, so there are all those kinds of challenges.
Okay.
When people see a woman on the front line.
And
yes.
they question it.
Yeah.
Can you imagine that? All right, so let's move on to, you know, Reverend Lucy Natasha, the person.
Mm-hmm.
What is it that you do when you're not, you know, you know, in your outreach programs?
Uh-huh. Mm. When I'm not on my outreach programs, most of the times I love to read and write books. I'm also, by the grace of God, I've authored 4 books.
Yeah.
One is Touching Heaven Through Prayer, which has really been a blessing to many people. Mm-hmm. 7 Keys to Success. Mm-hmm. Every problem has an expiry date. Mm-hmm. And characteristics of a God's leading lady.
Right.
So I write, I read, but apart from that, mm-hmm. I also love listening to music.
Okay. What kind of music?
I listen to gospel.
Okay. Definitely.
Yeah. Oh my God.
Uh-huh.
I listen to music.
Do you cook?
I love cooking.
Really?
By the way. Yeah. Although
what do you cook best?
I cook best fried rice. Vegetable
okay.
fried rice.
With what?
And chili chicken.
Oh, okay. That yes. sounds delicious.
Yeah. So and mashed potatoes.
And mashed potatoes. All right. So one of the questions, like we mentioned when we started, people were asking, are you single? First of all, let's get it out there. Mm-hmm. Are you seeing someone else? Mm-hmm. Are you dating? Are mm-hmm. you single?
Yeah,
married?
Yeah, it's a good question because life is in seasons and life is in stages. And actually...
Such a diplomatic way to start.
Uh-huh. Glory to Jesus. So anyway, life is in season and in stages.
Right.
And right now, you know, singlehood is also a season. Right now, I'm in that season. And as I trust God to get into the next stage, which mm-hmm. is the stage of marriage, when God divinely connects me with the God-fearing and the right person.
Mm-hmm.
But as per now, I'm in that stage and enjoying myself on that stage, serving the Lord
uh-huh.
and having the best of that stage.
So who's your ideal man? In case they are watching, you know, mm-hmm. I mean, maybe the blessing is coming tonight.
Amen. You never know.
You would never know.
That's right.
Yeah.
My ideal man, Betty, would be a man that has high family values because I have a lot of family values. A man with high family values. Mm-hmm. Also, a man that is born again. And he has to be born again, though it's not a must that he
yeah,
has to
because
be.
You can actually help them yeah. into the yeah.
No, he has
into
to be
salvation.
Born. No,
you don't want.
It is he has to be born again.
Why is
but
that?
But he doesn't have to be a pastor. You know, the Bible says, "Do not be equally yoked with unbelievers." So,
uh-huh.
For me, I cannot be able to get into a relationship or get married to a man that is not born again. So
you cannot, if it's just helping them, you know, in that journey
no,
together.
Not for marriage. Maybe for other things, but anybody is welcome to my ministry in
yeah.
spite of where they are coming
okay.
from. But
yes,
for
yes.
marriage, it has to be a man because this is a lifetime commitment.
True.
And you know, marriage is for keeps. So it has to be a man that mm-hmm. is that is born again, high family values,
mm-hmm.
and a man that also believes in the calling and in the grace of God that is upon my life. And also a friend, you know, somebody
mm-hmm.
that you are compatible with.